AI for better health diagnostics. So we are sector agnostic, we cut across the board. We'd like to see businesses that have a strong path to profitability and at the same time do good for the society in job creation, addressing pressing health needs, addressing pressing social needs, etc.
Hi everyone, this is Tarun from Matrix. Actually not very dissimilar to Inventus. So we're an early stage tech focused VC fund. We're a 350 odd million fund in India, currently investing out of our second fund. In terms of stage, I would say we generally enter at Series A and do a little bit earlier, do a little bit later. So I would say seed to Series B is sort of the center of the box for us. In terms of areas of focus, anything which is consumer internet, mobile, SaaS is stuff that we look for, tech or tech enabled. And some of the companies that you know we've been fortunate to partner with early include Ola, Practo, Daily Hunt, M-Swipe, and a few others.
Rahul.
Thanks, Preeta. Yeah, hi, morning. I'm Rahul Chandra. I'm one of the co-founders of Helion. And some of you may have seen, now I played two roles. One is the management of the Helion portfolio. So from that series of funds, we are fully invested. I've recently launched a new fund called Unitary Helion, and the focus of Unitary Helion is on two areas. One of the areas is marketplaces, where a lot of the informal trade which happens in India, or a lot of discovery which then leads to a transaction between businesses or consumers, that coming onto a formal marketplace which then has a lot of access to data, does an escrow on the payments, apply to multiple verticals. And the verticals that I'm focusing on are logistics, healthcare, financial services. And the second big area is everything to do with technology disruption around financial services, which includes payments as well as tech-based lending and insurance. So those are the narrower focus areas for Unitary Helion. And you know, and that's that fund is a $100 million fund looking to invest in companies which are very product and data centric. So, you know, investing behind products which are reaching a place where they are fitted with the market and then coming in after that. So that's the new focus for us.
Thank you. So Vineet, starting from you, while we were discussing backstage, you told me that there are close to 21 exits with which Aavishkaar has seen. So in terms of social, people actually don't relate returns or investment in the social sector. And if we speak to entrepreneurs to start something in the social segment, they're a little bit scared in terms of whether they would be able to scale up or not. So what are your thoughts on that?
I think there is a misnomer about social sectors, because I believe, even if Parag believes that he's unsocial, there's nothing unsocial, because if you are talking about Facebook or you're talking about anything that you're doing on the internet, it probably is the new social. So society is about people interacting and solving your problems, and in some sense technology has actually played a very big role, like mobile phones are big disruptors in the way you communicate. So whether you will call Airtel or Vodafone or Reliance Jio as a social service or not, but for people it is a social service, because you take away mobile phones today, you would actually see a very unintegrated world, and that actually will be a big problem. So the reality of it is social challenge is something that you deal with every day. You must have driven here in Delhi, and I can tell you, I'm coming from Bombay, that the speed, average speed for last 2 days have been 5 kilometers an hour. That's a fairly significant social challenge. And if you can figure out, and you start looking at the negatives of that social challenge, that you're burning so much of fuel that we import as a country, you are actually adding so much of carbon dioxide to the environment, and at the same time, you're making your life miserable by spending so much time on the road. That's actually a social challenge. And if you find a solution and make India one of the most efficient transportable country, you could probably be a social entrepreneur and you will be a very rich guy. Our general belief is that the problems in the world need to actually be looked at from a lens where you can make them sustainable or you can resolve them sustainably. You cannot expect the government to solve your problems. Entrepreneurs are supposed to create disruptions, and in case you create disruption, you will be able to actually create significant value for yourself. There are some social problems that can never have a business model, so I will leave them aside. For example, Mahatma Gandhi was a great disruptor, but Mahatma Gandhi did not try to build a business model around what he achieved for India. I don't think so you can put in a business model but there are many other things where you can put in a business model and create disruption, and I can give you some examples. Some of you, probably most of you, would have heard about microfinance. This was actually a big disruption when a professor in Bangladesh made this claim that poor are bankable. This is actually completely contrary to that to any bank till 1974 has ever thought about, that poor can be bankable. The value of that statement itself could be in billions of dollars. Just to let you know that in 2005, the entire microfinance outstanding of this country was less than $100 million. And just 12 years down the line, it would be actually surprising for you, but the total outstanding in microfinance will be in excess of $100 billion if you take into account all the priority sector lending that the microfinance and the self-help group outstanding along with the microfinance institution outstanding. Now, this is the kind of size one can talk about. So you can move from 500 crores to 1 lakh crores in 12 years. That's, in my view, is actually a disruption that creates significant value and worth, and that's essentially what we are trying to do. And if you make your choices right, which is what my other colleagues are doing, identify an entrepreneur who has the idea that is scalable, has the patience and the capability to build an institution and requires capital, and you make that investment in that person, then generating 21 exits is not really a great achievement over the last 17 years. We made 50 odd investments, 21 exits, deployed more than $200 million in these areas, and we are raising another $200 million fund, which hopefully will be closing next month.
Parag, you have made some interesting tech investments in companies like Power to SME or Policy Bazaar for that matter. So how does an entrepreneur approach you in terms of it's the same tech segment or the same fintech space? So how you assess them in terms of, okay, whether they have the capability to scale it up further?
So I think if you look at VC investing in general, there are three basic things that we look at. One is the team, the composition, for example. The second is the market, how attractive is it, how fast is it growing. And the third is the competitive advantage that somebody brings to the table. So those are the three things that you look at. And product could be one way for competitive advantage, for example. So each of these entrepreneurs and the companies, underlying companies, you put through that lens, essentially that lens. Now, those are very broad buckets. You have to go under the surface. For example, in the team, you might want to call up five people who have worked with Funny or Yashish in the past. The fact that we have been around for a while in corporate, in VC, have the set of contacts, Bangalore is the place that it is, etc., etc., you can do a 360 on anybody, for example. And similarly, on the market, you can speak to experts, etc., etc. But at the end of the day, at a Series A, it is as much a bet on the entrepreneur as on the business. So we end up being right about the entrepreneur most of the time. We have, in our 21 companies, I think we regret investing in India. We regret investing in about two of those entrepreneurial teams. So the rest of them that are not successful are because the market failed. Which is we took a certain bet on the market. InstaHealth, a company that got sold to Practo, we had a reasonable return. Very, very good entrepreneur. But he was against a set of headwinds that were very, very difficult. Indian hospitals, small Indian hospitals, do not pay for software. Internet at that time, SaaS in 2009, was just too early. So that's the focus. Essentially, back a decent team and hope the market works out is what Series A investing, in my mind, is all about.
Ruchira, you have been investing in, say, impact space, and besides that, there's the commercial ventures as well. I'm saying you have been investing in the impact space plus the commercial side, right? Yes. So how IFC as a fund balances out the two?
Yeah, as I was saying earlier, it's important for us to see both. If we don't see an impact story in an investment, we don't explore it further. So the first time a business plan hits us, we will look at it and we'll ask ourselves the question, is there impact from what this business is trying to create? More often than not, there is, right? Because every investment creates employment, every investment tries to solve some need. And if we find the depth of that impact or the nature of that impact is not deep enough, we will then pass, right? So it could be creating employment, but for, you know, for a sort of relatively frivolous cause, we will then pass on that. But more often than not, there is some impact, and that is a genuine reason to pursue it further. But for us, impact is a necessary but not a sufficient condition. So once that initial condition is met, we will go down the same road that Parag was talking about. How good is the team? How good is this entrepreneur? Have they done stuff in the past that gives us confidence in their ability to build and scale this business? What is the TAM, the target addressable market, for this space? Is this likely to continue to grow? We are very wary of very small market sizes. So when people come and say, I have this brilliant solution, but this market itself is small, we trust shy away from those spaces. It has to be a big market where even if the entrepreneur succeeded in getting, say, 5% of the market, it's still a reasonably sized business. So we go after large spaces where the impact potential can be multiplicative. We then look at the economics very closely. We want to ensure that it's unit economic positive. Or if it is an earlier stage business where unit economics has not been proven out, at least there is a path to unit economics becoming positive in the next 12 to 18 months. And based on some of those core metrics, decide on the commercial viability. And that's how we balance both before we take things further.
So Tarun, over to you. So how your approach differentiates from, a fund like Helion in terms of dealing with the same set of entrepreneur who is, say, pitching to you or pitching to Rahul?
So I don't know how it's different, but let me try and answer, let me try and answer that question in a little bit of a different way in sort of how we think about investing. So I think, pretty much every investor in the world, every venture investor in the world for sure will tell you, you look at team, market, business model, product, etc. I think, and every investor has their own thesis. There are some investors which will be a little bit more overweighted on the market opportunity. There'll be some investors who will be a little bit more overweighted on the founder and the team. I think we are in the latter category. So I would say, given the stage at which we invest, which is largely, seed or series A, our bet, I would say, almost 100% of our decision is based on the capability of the team. So what do we look for? We look for people who not necessarily have been there, done that. I think it's not something that, we have seen as a big predictor of success. In fact, if at all, we've actually seen the reverse, that people who don't really have experience in that space have gone on to disrupt markets, right? Case in point, Ola. Bhavish never ran a travel or transport company, but he's gone on to build the largest outcome in that space. Case in point, Shashank, he was a third-year engineering graduate. He's built the largest health tech company in India. So I think what we like to overweight on is more, I would say, the intrinsics of the team. What is their ambition? Do they have a unique insight on that space? Do they have the ability to, build and sort of attract a high-quality team? Are they in this for the right reasons other than just money? We have a preference towards missionary entrepreneurs, who would break through a wall, so to speak, before they'd give up. So I would say we would pretty much decide on, yes, we look at market, yes, we look at business model, yes, we look at this thing. To the point that Parag said earlier, it's extremely hard to figure out something, because on paper in India, the dichotomy is every market looks, it's a tiny market. And so I'll give you one example. When we invested in Ola, and this was 2012, there was Tab Cab, Meru Cab, Mega Cab, Easy Cab, Quick Cab. I could name 20 companies. Not a single company had been able to cross more than 30, 40, 50,000 rides a day. And so we actually did not like the cab market. We felt it was extremely hard for any single player to scale to get a national presence. But then we met Bhavish and we said, well, if there's one person who we think is going to change that, it's going to be this gentleman. He was a 24-year-old kid at that time. And we thought his understanding and his unique sort of insight in how he's going to crack that market would allow him to scale nationally. This was, by the way, well before Uber was known to any of us, definitely not known to me. I think Uber had just raised its Series A round in San Francisco. So none of us knew about how large his opportunity could potentially be in globally. But today, you know, he's gone from 1,000 rides a day 4 years ago to 1.5 million rides a day in 4 years. Now, theoretically, that market was always large, right? The, India always had, you know, 300-400 million people in urban across the top 10-20 cities. Delhi Metro was doing, or Bombay Metro, Bombay local train was doing, you know, 10 million rides a day. So the market always existed. It's just that you needed that special entrepreneur to be able to go out there with the right product to be able to expand and capture that market. And so our thesis is, even if we don't like a market, we will still invest if we find an exceptional entrepreneur. And I think that's what makes us different.
So Rahul, does the same approach apply to your, say, VC mindset as well? Okay, if it's a market, it's more about the entrepreneur, whether he'll be able to scale up or not, even if it's competitive for a segment like marketplace, which you just mentioned. If it's a for a segment like marketplace, which you just mentioned, you would be interested in.
You know, I think it's always case to case, so it depends on the space that we're looking in. And, you know, by and large, the last few years has been a combination of, you know, people looking at problems for the first time. I agree with Ruchira that the problem by default have to be large problems. And by large, you know, I also agree with Tarun that, you know, it's very hard to, I've written an article on LinkedIn on how many mistakes I've made in assessing markets and said no to all the big companies that you see around 10 years back. And that was mostly me trying to do something on Excel and coming to a number which was completely, not encouraging at all on looking forward. But over time, entrepreneurs have either created these markets themselves or, you know, some disruptive changes have happened in the market. The way I like to think and remind myself nowadays that India recreates itself every 5 years. So if you were here 5 years back, you are redundant now because either you reset your mind or you, you know, keep making the same mistakes again. Because dramatic changes happen every 5 years. And five is a random number, by the way, which I just came up with. But when I look at 2006 is when we first came in, and 2011 when we had to do the reset with a bunch of things changing. That was 5 years. So I'm just assuming another 5 years, dramatic changes will happen again, which is happening around now. And so one is this reset. The other is, you know, keeping everything that that the folks on my left have said. The part I've struggled with as an investor has mostly to do with the stage of company that I'm investing in, which is, you know, either sometimes before product market fit or after product market fit. And I've seen that the, you know, an entrepreneur's skills or really what they're putting most of their energy into is very dependent on what stage they are in. And then being able to see what is the right application of that skill is important to understand this, you know, the stage that they are in. So for example, some entrepreneurs are very good at tinkering and fiddling with the product until they get it right. And some entrepreneurs are very good with taking a working product and scaling it. And the exceptional ones can do both. So the search, as Tarun was saying, is for the exceptional ones who can take it from one end to the other. But the, you know, the thing that foxed me most was the stage. And you know, India by nature, a lot of entrepreneurs are not very data centric. And you know, in this fund that I'm doing now, most of my pursuit is around companies which are actually taking some sense from the data that they're looking at from the product, product's engagement with the customers. And hopefully, you know, we'll have better answers than in the last 10 years on what is the stage that we're looking at. Because for me, that is the one element that can be answered with something more than the gut. And one should get that answer. But other than that, I totally agree with not investing in niche markets and, of course, trying to look for those exceptional entrepreneurs who can do both.
common question for all of you. While looking at a certain market segment or entrepreneur, do you also look at the geographical spread of that, where that, entrepreneurs is based out of, or where the operations will be held? Any focus given on that?
So, not explicitly, I would say, but certain places are easier than other places. Just to give a flavor, for example, Pune has a certain catchment. Everybody who's from Pune tends to come back, and you can still recruit good online marketing people, good technology people, definitely in Pune. Take a city like Chennai, it becomes very difficult to get an online marketing or a product guy for whatever reason. Bangalore, in spite of all the mess that it is in and high cost, those things are not issues. So you have to be cognizant of that in any case. So what we have got some of our companies to do is to set up a Bangalore office, for example, or suggested it. I think it is has to be the CEO's call. Delhi, that not that much of an issue. I think in the last 10 years, Delhi has, NCR in general, has caught up to Bangalore on most of those fronts. So this becomes an issue in beyond Delhi and Bangalore in particular. Mumbai, I don't know where Mumbai is, so I can't even place it. Powai Valley goes up and then goes down, so I have no idea. But clearly, that factor does play a part. Second, I think, in businesses which expand from city to city, I should state that it is very hard. Okay, those are by definition very hard. They have Ola and others, we have Savari, Experience, e-techies and others. Every country, every city in India is different. Okay, for example, in Delhi, people behave a certain way, Bangalore behave a different way, they will bring their stuff there, they are more polite, all of that. Not only that, the channels through which you attract people, let's say Just Dial works in the top 5 cities in India, but doesn't work in Hyderabad. It's as different as that. So at times, this geographical expansion kind of companies, which go city by city, you look at a mainland China kind of a company, to take a non-tech example, it takes very long for some of those reasons, because every city, actually Indranagar is different from Koramangala in some senses, as far as restaurants go. So those businesses is the hardest to build. If you have a flavor element, et cetera, like in food, very, very hard to build is the other thing that we think. But anyway, many people have experience here in those kind of businesses.
Vineet, you want to add to that?
So for us, geography has been a very critical defining feature of making investments. First, we started up as a rural fund. So when we started in 2001, 2002, we were only focusing on rural India. Over a period of time, we have become less discerning on rural and urban India, but we continue to focus on states that normally capital will not go. So we probably are first investors in UP, Bihar, Jharkhand, Orissa, and states Tripura, Meghalaya, etc. Partly because we believe you can find a high quality entrepreneur, even though the ecosystem is very underdeveloped, but you can find a high quality entrepreneur at a very reasonable price. And in case you are able to build a company there, chances are that you will have very little competition for a significant period of time. It's also our understanding that once you build a company like this, you will be able to attract Matrix and Helion and other investors, including IFC, down the line to participate in these companies and take them further up. So capital finds it very difficult at seed stage to go to areas and geographies where ecosystem doesn't exist of the quality and kind that exist in Bangalore or Pune or Mumbai or Delhi. But once you have built something, the value of that asset and its ability to scale and grow, given that those markets are probably not as rapidly evolving as the remaining markets, which are very urban centers are. And we have been using this strategy. Just to give you an example, we have used a very contrarian strategy to make investments in dairy in 2 states in India, Orissa and Jharkhand. Both of these states are milk dry states. So logically, any investor who would try to make an analysis and make investments in a dairy would want to go to states which produce large amount of milk and not states that don't produce milk. We took a conscious decision to actually go into these two states because we knew there is no private dairies there. And if you build a private dairy, chances are that you would be able to create significant value. Milk Mantra, I think the promoter is going to be speaking in one of the sessions here. We went in 2011-2012, ranked startup with no real backend, and in 6 years, 5 years' time, the company is actually the largest private dairy probably in the Eastern India, clocking probably going to cross 300 crores. And we have replicated that in Jharkhand, where we created a new company called Osam, which is also going to hit 100 crores in 2 years since its operation started. So geography can be used as a very strong this thing. You might have to have a very high risk appetite, and you need a very large team to manage the kind of constraints and challenges that are generated in those geographies. So they are very unique challenges that come associated with the geography that you choose as well.
Ruchira, your thoughts?
So we really do not opine on where the business is headquartered, and that makes sense for the stage we come in at. By the time we come in, if it's, you know, Series B or later, that decision is made, and we would never be asking the entrepreneur to change that. We leave that to be solely the decision of the entrepreneur and his management team. To Vineet's point, are certain markets more interesting than others? Yes, they are from an impact perspective. Because impact is an important part of the story for us, we want to see low-income states seeing some of the benefit of the business being created. We want to see the business expand beyond the tier one metros to tier two and tier three cities. So we look for those elements. They don't have to be there when the business first approaches us, but we want to be able to see a path of growth in those markets.
So again, no preference. What we do see is, again, given the sectors that we focus on, I would say 95% plus of the teams that we meet are based either in Delhi or Bangalore, largely I would say these two cities. We have invested in companies outside Delhi and Bangalore as well. We've done investments in Chennai, in Jaipur, in Bombay, and a bunch of others. I would say, you know, at least what when I look at companies, and I think we've seen this learning from both Ola and Quikr, I think we have a 50 engineer rule. If your company will require more than 50 engineers to build out, at some point our view is the entrepreneur himself or herself will decide to move to Bangalore, because it's extremely hard to find 50 high quality engineers who are a great culture fit for the company that you're building outside Bangalore. At least that's been our experience. So it's not something that we would obviously push. We're happy to invest anywhere. So Ola moved when they were in the 50 to 100 engineer mark. They moved from Bombay to Bangalore. Quikr did the same thing. So I would say I think Delhi, Bangalore are turning out to be the two larger hubs.
I mean, 90% of our deal flow is from Bangalore and Gurgaon, or Delhi. Noida and Gurgaon, actually, more specifically. But I think preference-wise, the place which gives you the fastest access to resources, which is Bangalore, actually. Engineering resources in the early years are very critical. You know, it's very hard to shift people to work in a startup in a different city. So Bangalore is the most accessible city. And preference-wise, if the question is preference, Bangalore is certainly the highest preference.
Sure. Moving on, if we talk from a different perspective, it's not just the money which every entrepreneur says that I'm looking for from investors. It's more about the thoughts, the health, or maybe a stage comes when a pivot is needed at an entrepreneur's business end. So any case studies, examples you guys could share with us wherein you really handholded the entrepreneur towards his way up, or you showed him light at the end of the tunnel? You want to start?
I'll just rephrase the question. I mean, if we are handholding the entrepreneur, then there's something wrong with it, obviously, right? There is, the entrepreneur is the one, but I think I'll just rephrase it to saying that where have we added value, right, besides just investing money? I think the areas in which we add value in the initial years are, again, very different from the later years. In the initial years, we will work on things like, just keeping a very tight discipline around growth. So we try and break down plans into shorter and shorter modules. So we go from What people are used to is to writing, you know, 12-month plans. We get it down to 3-month plans and a weekly plan. And then our engagement is very intense. So, you know, at the end of the day, we're just being, you know, painful people who ask for how much have you grown last week? You know, and, you know, people hate us in the beginning, but then they start enjoying the fact that when you look at 3 months, you know, it's actually an upward trajectory. And it's something that problems are getting solved on a weekly basis in order to achieve that. And of course, when problems get boiled early on, it's better to solve them instead of discovering them slowly. So what a 90-day period does is really cause a lot of churn in the system because you're trying to run very quickly. You're trying to do a 100-meter sprint, even though the journey is a marathon, but you simulate a 100-meter sprint. So you understand which part of your body is giving up, and then you replace that. So the, you know, the what we help in the initial stages is really to get the engine in the right place and fill in all the gaps. And there's a lot of back and forth on what kind of help can we provide in those 90 days to 6 months. And in the later stages, once the company is past a Series B, then, you know, there are always challenges like helping the entrepreneurs figure out a good fundraising strategy, who to reach out to, making connects. So, you know, a lot of time later on goes into, you know, you're confident that you've got a great company, good entrepreneur, but now you want to get it out into the market. And, you know, so calling up Tarun and saying, you know, here's a company you should look at and why, you know, that would be something I would spend a lot of time on. And, you know, I'm sure there are obvious answers, but I'll, you know, leave something for the others as well. So.
Sure, but here I am more looking at some examples, some case studies from each one of you. I mean, in yeah. case you feel you've really been like more of a, say, guiding hand to the entrepreneur.
I agree with Rahul that, you know, we shouldn't be using the term handholding. Entrepreneurs know the business better than us, and we as investors are supposed to support them. But the way we add value is through board meeting discussions as well as in between board meetings. And I would say the job of an investor in adding value, the biggest job is to ask the right questions. Because we are not, you know, it's quite likely that a management team that's very close to the problem and the day-to-day issues sometimes loses sight of some particular aspect of the situation. And because we are more distant, we can ask those probing questions. And so just asking more and more questions and provoking the thinking is the value we add best. And then a step further than that is when some, you know, answers are discovered or being brainstormed, making the right connections, making the introductions, making things happen for the entrepreneur is where we can add value. But not for a minute do I believe that we are in the driver's seat. They are certainly running their business. We have a more supportive role.
So we invest in technology companies. If they need support on the technology side, then we are gone in any case. So that is left out. I think where sounding board is the best thing in my mind. The business learnings, an example. This is 2015, mobile first. All of that, remember, Policy Bazaar, large investors, much larger than us, on the table, pushing him towards mobile first. And here was this one guy who could think contrarian, who has seen Funds India because he's seen it for longer, realizes that in the financial services world, it will take a lot of time before we get there. So I could stand up and tell him, do not focus that much on it, hedge your bets. 3 months later, the mobile first was gone. So to that extent, that took up my credibility with the Yashish, for example. So that's how you do things. You don't fundamentally change the direction of the company, but you help a guy think through. Funny, fairly young when he started off at Red Bus. Basic business stuff, he didn't know. There was a young team as well, jealousies, everything. So you have to act as an agony aunt in those situations. Redbus was growing very fast, but there were huge amount of reconciliation problems. Nats at Helion stepped in and helped with some of that. So it is very situation specific. This value add is a very, very gray concept, let's put it that way. It depends on what an entrepreneur needs. And Narayan at Power to SME is a fairly mature entrepreneur. He uses me as a sounding board. If he has some trouble in his management team, I know all of them. I take an effort to know each CXO. He'll call me up and say, Parag, what do you think? So I think that is, what do you think is the question. It's not, our job is at most to generate alternatives, not to suggest a specific solution. And if you know the business, if you know the people involved, you can help him either narrow down on solutions or generate a few solutions.
Our case may actually be slightly different from my colleagues on the panel, partly because we invest in unique geographies. And in addition to that, Aavishkaar has been continuously not hesitating from taking majority positions. So, I mean, we have 40% of our companies where we're in majority. And that actually pushes us to not do value addition, because if I'm investing in a hospital business and the doctor doesn't know how to do operation, there's no value addition I can do. So he needs to do what they need to do. There is a significant amount of other decision making where we have seen continuously emerging challenges, specifically if the entrepreneurs are not coming from a, if they are a first generation entrepreneur and they have never run a company before. And those challenges, even if that happens, if the person is coming from a very significant corporate background. So if you have 20 years of corporate experience, unfortunately you have run businesses which already has systems and processes in place. So when you start a company and you have to put in place systems and processes, it's very difficult for you if you've never done it yourself for the first time. And we have repeatedly seen that people coming from very different backgrounds have different challenges. Our focus generally has been to look at the entrepreneur, look at the business model, and see if he knows the core, and he has a deep and core understanding of his area. We have invested in some of the companies from an experimental perspective. I'll give you an example. We were looking for a waste management company which doesn't work with municipalities and create private and still creates value. We found two young guys working in Ahmedabad who were working with rag pickers. We gave them $500,000 or 2-3 crore rupees. And over a period of time, they tried to scale because they thought since we have come in, they need to scale. And in the process of scaling, they put together a huge amount of plastic waste in one place. And on a Diwali night, the whole yard went up in flames. So our total investment was written off. We went back to the entrepreneurs. We had by that time realized two things. One, the business model, the way it was presented to us, is not going to be scaled up. But we also realized that the entrepreneurs are very capable, very passionate, and a deep understanding of the business that they were doing. What they needed was a little bit of discussion around where they need to go. And once we pushed them, they actually did come up with the idea of scaling this business up by mechanizing the whole process of dealing with the rag pickers, reducing the inventory, so not having large inventories stacked up. And for that, they needed to mechanize, which means they not needed $500,000, they needed $5 million. And that amount of significant investment would change the contour of the game. And in 2.5 years from a company that had gone bankrupt and has actually burnt, was completely decimated, this company has now gone to start processing waste of 100 tons per day. And it's just took 2.5 years. And the value addition was just to force them to think beyond what they were doing, to think something which was new. And some of these situations come to us because of the unique situations and challenges that we face, given that we are not operating in very evolved ecosystems of IT, mobile, etc.
Tarun, you want to add any example?
I think just we stay out of the way. I think there's a joke going around that most investors destroy value, so we try not to do that. I think going back to the original point I made, I think if you're investing in exceptional entrepreneurs, they don't really need too much. They definitely don't need a guiding hand. They definitely don't need handholding or anything of that sort. I think echoing some of the thoughts that, you know, Parag and, you know, everybody else has made is, yes, you do help generate alternatives. Yes, you do help sort of, you know, be a sounding board. I would say three areas that, you know, when entrepreneurs ask me what can Matrix do for me, I answer that in three ways. One is what we have seen, because we back generally very young entrepreneurs, they don't have a lot of experience building teams. And some of us have made several mistakes in hiring people And so I think we have some of those learnings that we can share with the entrepreneur. So generally the L-1 team of the founder, we play a very key role in helping them put together, right? And so that's one value add that we do. So whether it's the, you know, marketing head or the product head or whatever it is, that's generally one sort of set of people that we will try to help build and help them build the team. So that includes, you know, again, just helping them source high quality candidates, helping them convince high quality candidates to join the team that early when nobody knows that company, helping them with reference checks on the team, again, which is something we can do easily. So I would say team building is one big area. The second I would say is maybe take one strategic project in a year, which is important but not urgent. And if it's not important and not urgent, then entrepreneurs generally never find the time for it. So we do tend to help with, for example, if there's a company that is currently operating in India but is thinking about which other market to tackle next. That's important, but if it's not urgent, generally the founder will probably not get to it early enough. And so we'll try and help him with doing some of that market study and coming back to him and saying, hey, here's what analysis says. You know, why don't you spend some more time on it and see if you agree. And I think the last one is, you know, we try and help prevent $1 million mistake a year is what we say. Generally, you know, we've seen young entrepreneurs wanting to do too much. And when they try to do too much, they end up sort of making more mistakes than they should. And our job is to help prevent one such big mistake a year. And so I think I would say, you know, distill down to these three things.
Sure. So before I throw the floor open for questions, one last for each one of you. So how much we push our entrepreneurs towards profitability as investors?
Yeah, this is a very tough question. Thankfully, it's the last one, so we can wrap up very quickly. But the, at least, I mean, personally, or for Helion, I would say, I think we are more on the, you know, at least defining and being profit aware, you know, or contribution margin aware. We are, we would tend to, you know, remind people more of thinking of the bottom line and of the, you know, of the cost elements vis-a-vis growth versus just growth. So how much would we ask for profit? At some point, we would ask for it every day. We would ask for more profit, you know, but that finding that point is the key. You know, at what point is the right point to ask? You know, elements that go into that are obviously, you know, market maturity, company maturity. Are we in a, you know, 1 year cycle where we're looking to sell, or the business is, you know, is ripe for selling? You know, obviously there is the other, you know, market element of there is no funding in sight. You have to go towards profitability. You know, so there are different elements that go into it. But when everything is fine, when there is enough capital, when there is growth that is infinite that can be achieved, then we don't talk about profitability at all. Then we just would emphasize on, you know, it becomes a double-edged sword. We obviously are aware of that, so we would not emphasize it in the zone where it is ideal to just grow. But when there is no money to grow, or when there is time to sell, then, or the company has reached a point of maturity, we would certainly push for it pretty hard.
So I think given the stage at which we enter and the stage at which we invest, you know, sometimes we have the dubious distinction of a company that was profitable becomes unprofitable once we invest. But that's also because, you know, there is a growth profitability continuum, and, you know, companies that were optimizing for profit because they didn't have the capital to grow suddenly start investing in growth, and that's fine, and we understand that. But I think just taking again from Rahul's point, I think the area that I think we spend time is more on the unit economics and understanding the underlying profitability of the model, not specifically is the company profitable itself or not. Because again, at seed, Series A, Series B, Series C, even it's a choice that you're making to invest more in growth versus profitability, and to gain more market share and to gain competitive advantage and stuff like that. But yeah, I think in terms of making sure that the business model at scale can make money, is definitely something that we spend time on. So what is gross margin? What is your contribution margin? Are you making money per order? Once you account for a marketing, you know, customer acquisition costs, can this business ever make sense? Those are the kind of areas that we spend time on. Less on, you know, how much profit are you generating, because none of these companies generate profit.
And they're surrogates of profitability, right? CAC is something that we would always want to see going down. Cost of acquisition of customers. That's not something we would like to see growing beyond a point. You know, and that's the biggest factor going into profitability for unit economics. So we use that as a surrogate that over time that should continue to come down. And so without going into the contribution margin line, we at least would look at, you know, CAC reducing.
Yeah, I think a clear path to profitability eventually is important. And I would reiterate what has been said here, that it depends on the fundamentals of the business. For us, because we invest across stages, we see both aspects. For a late stage business that is still burning on the gross margin level, we're not happy with that. So if it's a late stage business, I would like to see at least gross margin and in some cases contribution margin profitability. I'm okay if it's not EBITDA positive yet. For an earlier stage business, we are okay if it isn't gross margin or contribution margin positive, as long as there's a path to getting there. We also dig a little deeper and try to understand why is money being lost. If money is being burnt to shift customer behavior in creating new markets, we are supportive of that. Because in a country like India and across most emerging markets where IFC invests, new markets and new opportunities need to be created. And to create those new markets, you need to shift customers from doing X to doing Y, buying a particular way to buying a different way. And that requires incentivizing, prompting, having a very fluid, smooth customer experience, and all of that requires investing. So, or even deals and discounts to shift consumer behavior. If you're gross margin negative for that reason, we see that going away over time and turning to gross margin profitable. If on the other hand, you're burning money at the gross margin level because you are trying to protect and preserve your market share in a hyper-competitive market, we don't see that as a good use of capital. So it has to be evaluated at the next level of detail. But overall, it is a very important metric for us, and it may not be a necessary requirement when we get in, but it has to be, as I said, a path to profitability has to be clear. We need to be able to see the business getting there, because in my mind, any impact is only sustainable if it's commercially viable. Otherwise, it's not an impactful venture.
I think between the three of them, they've covered most of it. So VC investment, just like most important things in life, is a balance between scale. I think Tarun referred to it in different words, but between scale and profitability. All of us on that spectrum sit in different places. It depends on orientation of the investor, some more conservative than others. It also depends on the fund size, for example. Take an example. I'll take an example from the Matrix portfolio. Ola. We saw it fairly early, thanks to IIT Bombay. Two of us come from IIT Bombay, et cetera, et cetera. But the issue between that company and a company we funded called Savari was profitable here and now. Ola was not. You have to realize that in Ola's case, in Bangalore, for example, as a city, till you have 1,500 taxis, you'll lose money, okay? That's a reality. 1,500 might be 1,200 or 2,000, but there is a threshold. Now, as a small fund, $100 million fund, can I fund five cities like that, or even two cities like that, till he gets to 2,000, is the question. So we chose Savari, and now we think, did we do the right thing? So it's a very delicate balance. Now, Axel, I think, has done it well by having till some time back, a godfather called Tiger, okay, who would back them up. So for a small fund, one way to do it is have a godfather and do it. Do those models which lose money on a variable basis till a point in time, and then it turns. And when it turns, you make a lot of money. But because of who we are, we have tended to go for here and now. So we do not make what I call errors of commission. We'll not make stupid mistakes like housing, okay? But we'll miss Ola, given our orientation. So that's where the conundrum is, and we need to solve for the second. We really, clearly need to solve for the second.
I think the challenges have already been highlighted, but I actually would go with Parag's last thing. It's the investor, his or her capacity to either support the company while achieving, going for scale with their own capital, or have the capability to work with the entrepreneur and attract more capital in case you are going for massive scale. A significant number of successes that come out of Silicon Valley have not happened simply because they had the best ideas. It has happened because they had an ecosystem that has the ability to keep mobilizing significant amount of capital for a very long period of time without seeing profitability. And I call it the paradigm shifting investments. When you make a paradigm shifting investment, you need to have the capital to back the change that you're trying to pursue. At Aavishkaar, we have been largely very conscious on unit economics, like everybody else here spoke about. Unit economics is important because something that doesn't make in money at any at small scale will not make money at large scale. As you try to scale, there will be new elements that will come in which will create negative cash flow. So profitability as in P&L doesn't probably deter any venture capitalist, because that's not really important. Till the time you are confident that the unit economics of the business at scale would play out and will deliver significant results. And that's essentially what we all chase, not necessarily the profit at P&L level.
Floor is now open for questions, so please your hands and identify yourself, and please point out to whom the question is targeted.
Good morning, all. I really enjoyed the talk, every bit of conversation. I also took 20-page notes of whatever you said. So I have a question to all of you. Like, if an entrepreneur is looking for a Series A funding, and that whatever the business plan, the blueprint has been documented, well-researched from every aspect for like maybe last 2-3 years. Now, one situation is that the entrepreneur has yet not launched it. He's looking for money to launch it. But he's not looking for angel funding or small money. He's looking for Series A, then go Series B. So how much ready a VC would be to go for Series A funding in case one, when the operations has not been started? In case two, yes, maybe bootstrap, but operations started for 3 months or 4 months. So what is your take on that? And primarily my first part is important, that you know, how will you think that, given the team is a strong team, maybe from an institute, from a good institute of India, or so what is your take on that?
So I'll take that. I think it depends on each fund. Every fund has a very different philosophy towards this. For Matrix, I think we meet entrepreneurs like you every day. So we are very comfortable funding an entrepreneur with a PowerPoint deck. We've done that in Tribo, in Lime Road, and you know, dozens of other companies. So yeah, drop us a line, we'll be happy to meet.
So we are slightly different. We would not fund three guys in a business plan, whatever the backgrounds might be. That's not where we think we can judge businesses. When we judge Series A, we are judging both the team and the business, okay? The emphasis on the team might be slightly higher, but nevertheless, we are judging the business as well. So we do not stray to seed, or for that matter, do Series B. 85-90% of what we do is Series A. So either bootstrapped, angel funded, etc., bring it to us at that stage. 5-10 lakhs of revenues is good enough. Even that revenue is good enough per month, on a per month basis. But we want to see that so that we can kick the product around, speak to a few customers. If it is a consumer product, test it out ourselves.
If you pre-revenue, you're too early for us. We, as I said earlier, we typically used to do Series B and later. We have of late started looking at late Series A, but we never invest earlier than that. So for us, having reached a certain level of revenues, even perhaps 2 to 3 million a year would be important before we take a serious look. However, we start to engage pretty early because we are always out there to try to understand different business models, the kind of solutions that are coming into being, and to always meet smart young people like you. So happy to engage sooner, but to manage expectations, we probably won't be able to invest unless the revenues have started becoming reasonable.
I'm happy to invest even when you don't have a PowerPoint. So we have done that multiple times. People did not know how to make a PowerPoint plan. So.
Yeah, I mean, I've rarely seen entrepreneurs actually spend all their time with the pitch deck talking to investors because, you know, the energy or the idea is so time-bound and they're so excited about it that, you know, they usually cannot sustain just pure fundraising for too long. So they go back and build something, and usually for us, that's also a sign of how passionate you are about that idea. And because entrepreneurs are by nature builders, right? They're not fundraisers, they're not meant for fundraising. So we end up usually seeing some part which is built. And, you know, like Tarun said, everybody has a different range. Personally, I am a big fan of product thinking. So for me, I would love to see how the founders are thinking of products at least. Revenue, profitability, etc., is all very far off, but you know, at least the product thinking is very important.
They cannot scale up their operations. So where does the venture capitalist have SMEs, because their profit margins are not huge, but they certainly have certain amount of business because they have been in business for quite some time. So this is a big area where a lot of small town entrepreneurs can also come in, because bank would only fund according to their collaterals or their assets. But they do have the businesses which big businesses are doing, and they are very much capable of scaling it up. So how do venture capitalists help them? And if they do or they don't?
So if you look at one of us, problem definition for us is to make 10 to 20x on an investment. Okay. Certain businesses, by definition, allow that, and certain businesses don't. As a consequence, even in the most advanced markets, let's say technology businesses in the US, only 5% are VC funded. Because that's the way it is. 95% of those businesses will scale to 10 crores, 15 crores, $3 million, $5 million, might be very profitable, but that's it. When thinking about a venture capitalist, you have to realize that he's willing to lose his money, but he is looking at the upside. So the underlying business and the team should be able to show that upside rather than I'm protecting your downside. So if it is a protecting your downside kind of manufacturing business, and to be fair to you, I don't know what your manufacturing business is. So
I'm manufacturing printing inks, liquid printing inks, which big MNCs, Sakata, Sigwerk, DIC are making.
I don't know much about manufacturing, honestly, so I can't judge. But the point is that it should be scalable and
highly scalable.
It should be differentiated. Those are two key things. If there is a 7,000 crore company already, the basic
it's
question...
It's scalable. Obviously, the market is there. It's a 7,000 crore company. There are 10 companies like that who are doing those kind of turnovers. So there is scalability, obviously.
No, but the counter question is that 7,000 crore company can kill you tomorrow, isn't it?
Yes, but the potential is there to kill them also, if one has the funds. So there's two sides of the coin. If one can grow and kill them somehow.
I'll quickly add to that, which is, you know, like most people, any investor also is a human with money, right? That's the only difference. I think the quick add to what Parag is saying, that the the differentiation or the uniqueness, we also love listening to stories, right? We invest behind ambition. And if you were to stand up and say you're going to build the biggest global company in specialty ink in the world, and you know this is the reason why you feel passionate about it, or this is how you will build it, that story is really what is going to suck our attention in. And so differentiation and all is brought out by how you tell your story. So at the end of the day, the the way you would present, and share your ambition, that really is the key.
See, personally, I am from a small town like Saharanpur. I imported some UV Flexo material from Australia. I called scientists from there, even paid their flight tickets just to make UV Flexo ink. And in 2010, UV Flexo inks was only made by only one or two MNCs. And it was a 100% margin game that time. But I couldn't scale it up because the raw materials are all imported and I couldn't really import from my side. If I had a venture fund, then I would have scaled it up to any extent. So how does one go about for a small scale manufacturer if he has a high margin product also?
If you don't mind, I'll actually suggest that India has this problem. We have a very large number of entrepreneurs like you who are actually in unconventional businesses, sort of what we call the brick and mortar business that actually will follow a certain stage. But what is happening around in India right now is there is a significant change. A significant amount of capital raise that you would see from the fund is taking place by Indian entrepreneurs who, unlike what has happened in Silicon Valley, where people have made significant amount of money and wealth doing tech businesses, a large number of Indian investors are actually looking to do real-time, real kind of businesses like the one that you're doing. And there would be a large number of SME funds which will be coming up over a period of time. Right now, I can actually tell you a large number of family offices which are mushrooming at this point of time, and you might actually hear from some of my colleagues in the next panel of how they are looking at these things. People who would want to participate, who have capital and who would want to participate, there are of course some coming from technology background, but there are a significant number of them are coming from non-technology background. And I have recently been trying to raise money in India, and I have met a large number of high net worth individuals in India who would want to participate directly rather than invest in funds into people like you. So ultimately what you have to look at is, as Rahul mentioned, you've got to tell your story without forgetting about you are coming from small town. Saharanpur is not really very far from Delhi. I have seen people in extremely remote parts of India still ready to present themselves and raise money. So I don't think the money raising is a challenge today. If you can actually articulate yourself and find a way to reach the people who are interested in your business. Some of us here may not be interested in your business, so you might get discouraged. That's not really the reason. India has 1.3 billion people, and even 1% of them are fairly rich. That's a large amount of people.
Hi guys, so this is more of when do you guys plan to exit? Myself, Sarabjit, we are one of the fintechs working majorly aggressive towards the financial side. So I know you guys plan to do Series A and B and eventually keep moving on. But when do you guys really feel that this is the right time for you to either exit or you still keep moving on till the time the initial entrepreneur plans to exit as well? So what is your kind of exit strategies accordingly when you invest?
So we come from the viewpoint that we want to invest in a team that can go all the way to the exit, whether it is an IPO in an extraordinary case or to an M&A. So if we don't think the team is something that we feel comfortable about, we never like the business enough to say that, okay, we'll change the team in between and go. So ultimately, exit actually happens at the entrepreneur's this thing. At the end of the day, if an M&A has to happen, they don't need us. The buyer doesn't need us. The buyer needs the management. Okay. So to that extent, the exit has to be driven by the desires of the entrepreneur. Now, there is this unanswered question about our fund lives and all of that. Today, that question is solved by selling it to, let us say, some company will take 15 years to get there. Just Dial took 16 years to go public, for example. So if somebody had invested in year two, how does he exit if he has a 10-year fund? Then Just Dial can pass it on to a Sequoia, somebody like IFC or whoever, who comes in at a later stage and buys them out. So that's how it is solved. But I think the trigger, at least in our minds, is always the entrepreneur. That's what we have seen in Redbus and InstaHealth and other company of ours is getting sold. The trigger is the entrepreneur. He suddenly decides that it's not worth it for me. I've fought for too long, or I've penetrated the top tier cities, tier two is too hard, I don't want to go there. Whatever be his motivation, or I've been at it 7 years, this is not exciting me anymore, I want to do something else. Whatever be that motivation, you kind of go along with that. An investor has that exit trigger, investor has a little role to play in my mind.
I'll answer it at two levels. When we initially evaluate an opportunity, we look at what this opportunity will look like 5 years out. So we do our hypothetical exit calculation with a five-year horizon in mind. But that doesn't mean we are looking to exit in 5 years. And I, as Parag said, the exit event is dependent on several particular factors. The team itself, when they decide to pursue a particular option, the market, and other possible opportunities that may come knocking at the door. So the exit event itself is dependent on several factors. We, IFC as an investor, never pushes for it. In certain situations, collectively as a board, certain exit opportunities may be pushed for because the board thinks it's the right time, but even then, the founder and the CEO's participation and involvement is super critical. Because IFC invests balance sheet money, we don't have pressures around fund life, duration, etc., so we can stay on as long as it takes. We would stay on for the right exit outcome and not push for anything prematurely.
On a lighter note, Rahul and I were just sharing a joke. I think my answer was going to be, what is an exit? I think a lot of us are yet to see too many of them in this country. But I think, jokes apart, I think the answer is, again, very similar. I think most early stage funds, most venture funds, come with a standard 10-year life cycle, which can be extended at, you know, sometimes. And so all the investments we make with a 5 to 10 year horizon. And so honestly, it is up to the entrepreneur at some stage to figure out what would be the right exit for all his shareholders, investors, employees, themselves. And so whether it's M&A, whether it's some sort of strategic exit, whether it's some sort of IPO, all of those things are things that we would consider and largely driven by the entrepreneur.
All right then, so with that, we call it a wrap to our first fantastic session over there for the day two of the summit. Let's have a round of applause to thank all of our speakers. I'm going to request Punita to please present a token of thanks to all of our speakers as well. So if you may please do the honors. I'm going to request all of you to come together for a group photograph as well.